who recounts important elements of my story, this gun in my hand. Where am I? What is this place? Bill, are you there? Hey, Bill, where's the opening narration?
I'm scared.
Who are you?
Your narrator was supposed to announce me. I'm your special guest star for this episode, Zazu Pitts.
Do you know where Bill is?
I don't know where he is or where I am. You're Falk Ziljan, right? How could you lose your narrator?
I'm sorry. Let me light a match and we'll see where we are.
That's a little better. It looks like we're in a dark alley. Don't you have any streetlights in this town?
We must be in a neighborhood where they can't afford to replace burned-out streetlights.
We're in Hex Pantry.
Who's there? Is that Wordsmith?
Jeez, don't scare me like that. Sorry.
My match went out.
Does anybody have a flashlight? Maybe we can find something in that garbage can to make into a torch before you run out of matches.
Good idea.
Here, I found a wooden chair leg, and there's some kind of, support undergarment to wrap around the end.
Burning braziers, are we?
No, this is more like a, truss.
Oh my.
Wordsmith, this is Zazu Pitts. Miss Pitts, this is Roberto Zapata, also known as Wordsmith.
My pleasure, I'm sure. My name is actually pronounced Zazu, but everyone says Zazu, so now I'm stuck with that.
I need a recap of why we're here. I might have been pursuing some specific person or following a lead. Bill? Bill? Maybe he's asleep. I'll fire around in the air to get his attention. Wait, what's this in my pocket?
That gun in your hand?
No, I don't keep it in my pocket.
Well, how am I supposed to know? We never actually see if you keep it in a holster or the waistband of your trousers. You just say the thing and it's there in your hand.
It's a note in my pocket. It says, "Goodbye, cruel world," and it's signed Bill Narrator.
Do you think it's from Little Billy, or is it definitely his dad?
No. I didn't read it to the end. Bill Narrator Sr.
Oh, dear. I always thought your announcer sounded unhappy.
No, he sounds serious to set the dramatic tone for this show.
He always sounds chipper when he's doing a commercial.
That doesn't mean he's happy. It might mean he's putting on a brave face.
No, Bill has so much to live for. He had plans to have his own show. Plus, he would never leave Little Billy as an orphan. I think this is a setup. Someone kidnapped my narrator. The kidnappers wanted to throw us off the scent by making it look like he topped himself.
Oh, that sounds difficult.
I mean, they planted this fake note to lead us in the wrong direction.
A red herring?
No thanks. I had a cup of red sorghum, more or less instant hot breakfast paste, not long ago. It drives away the hungries all day.
How is it you can remember what you ate, but you need a recap of how you got here?
I don't know. Maybe I got socked in the back of the head and it gave me selective amnesia.
Now the torch is lit. Why don't you drop the matchbook here? It could be a clue for someone to find us later. You know, some detective finds the matchbook, sees the logo for the Kit Kat Club on it. He asks around at the Kit Kat Club. Nobody wants to talk. The detective threatens him. Finally, someone remembers seeing you or me there.
You go to the Kit Kat Club a lot?
It's just an example.
Well, the logo on my matchbook is from Felpausch General Store.
Let me see if I got a better matchbook I could drop.
Wouldn't it be easier to write a note and leave it where someone will find it instead of dropping it in an alley? Except who's going to come looking for us?
Jenny would come looking for me. I mean, she'd send one of her robots, a street urchins. Maybe Allie Catherine if she was really worried.
Oh, aren't we fancy? Having people who love you and worry when you don't show up. Must be nice.
It is.
Let's not stand here in the cold and dark. What does this narrator fellow look like?
I don't know. I've never seen him. It's not a visual medium.
If we find anybody tied up, we can remove his gag and ask him to say something. We'll recognize his distinctive voice.
I hadn't noticed anything distinctive about it.
Oh, yeah. He has a Midwestern accent. Almost Canadian.
Really?
Of course you wouldn't notice. He sounds exactly like you. Except tinier.
Is that what I sound like?
You must have heard yourself on the radio.
No, I never listen to my own show. Anyway, Parabellum City has weird acoustics. It makes everybody sound alike.
Maybe Bill was kidnapped from his house or the studio. We could look for clues at those places. Maybe someone can tell us when he was last seen or who was with him.
I vote for that.
You know where he lives?
Sure, I have my sources.
Word on the street?
No, it's Jenny, the informatron. She's my wife.
I know. I listened to the show.
She has much better words on the street than mine. Let's go.
How far is it?
Mile and a half, I think. And the buses don't run this late.
Could we play some interstitial music to indicate the time has passed? And then we'd just show up at the destination.
That would be nice, but Bill usually handles that kind of stuff.
He's your narrator, your announcer, and sound designer. Are you paying him enough for all these jobs?
I'm sure Gary gives him a healthy cut of the ad revenue.
I'm just thinking, maybe that would explain why he was so depressed.
He's not depressed.
So, did you guys hear who won the ball game?
No, I haven't been around a radio all day. Who was playing?
Santopolis Scarecrows versus the Parabellum City Pistol Packers.
I would have thought your word on the street would keep you apprised of baseball scores.
Ah, you know, kids these days. 23 street urchins following people around, peeping in windows, digging through waste paper baskets to read people's letters and report back to me. None of them follow sports.
Did you have money riding on the game?
No, I don't really care either. I was just making small talk. We can't fill 20 minutes with clopping footsteps.
If nobody else has anything, I could talk about my upcoming film roles.
Sure. You've been in all those comedy shorts with Thelma Todd, right?
Yes, but I'm tired of playing second fiddle. Roger Corman tells me he's going to make me a big star in feature films. He said his next picture will be Zazu Pitts and the Pendulum.
Why would you believe a kid? Roger Corman's only 14 years old.
Oh, don't you wish somebody was offering to put your name in lights? The green-eyed monster rears its ugly head.
Where? He must have busted out of Alcatraz. Doberman and Collie put the green-eyed monster behind bars 3 seasons ago.
Listen, my feet are killing me. Could we at least go to commercial? Then we can appear at our destination after the commercial ends. Do you need Bill Narrator Senior to cue that up for you, too?
No, I think I can just say, we'll return after this important message from our sponsor. Did it work? I don't think... Yeah, there it goes.
Thursday night at 8 o'clock is the time for Astro Police!
Decrease lateral thrusters by 3%.
Roger, Cap. Lateral thrusters decreased 3%.
Joe, prepare for docking sequence in 60 seconds.
Preparing to dock, Captain. You think they'll have any space donuts left at the Astro Precinct House, Joe?
I wouldn't count on it, Rocky. You know how those guys are.
It's not like we can run out of anything. Why don't you spend a few of your Astro credits in the Futuraca cycle to replicate more donuts?
I was hoping to save my credits and take Rosie out to that fancy new place on Rigel 15. They serve some kind of Portuguese-Venusian fusion cuisine.
You know, I admire you, Rocky. You don't let anybody give you guff about your wife being a, you know, a cleaning robot.
Well, why should I? That's nothing to be ashamed of. If she can settle down with a space flat foot like me...
Docking sequence, Joe.
I got it, Cap.
Your feeble, earthbound mind will be smashed to atoms by the nonstop excitement of Astro Police!
Why are you always yelling?
It's the canned atmosphere on these rockets! You have to shout to be heard over the engines!
We can hear you just fine.
Oh, are you sure? I don't mind projecting my voice if necessary!
We're sure.
All right. You fellows have any plans for this evening?
We got a space card game in the basement of the Astro Precinct House. Like I said, me and Rosie's going to that new joint, Bilbao Green.
I meant plans for the patrol. Are you tracking down any space criminals? Juvenile Astro hooligans taking rockets for joyrides?
Just a routine patrol. Search some spaceships, blast some off-worlders. We might take a pass through the Red Satellite District, collect some favors from the working girls and the working yowlquats. Right, boys?
And how?
That's Astro Police! Thursday nights at 8 p.m. on Drama 1310 a.m. WPBC!
Not to be confused with Astral Police, the detectives of the spirit realm. Those guys are jerks! We now return to No Large Bills, episode 107 of This Gun in My Hand. Get it? Bill Narrator Sr. is missing, so there's no large bills. When we last left our heroes, what were we doing before that commercial? I don't know how Bill keeps it all straight.
We were walking to Bill Narrator's house to look for clues to his disappearance.
Oh, brother, I hope there's no narrator's union or announcer's union.
What do you mean, Miss Pitts?
You just announced us to commercial and announced us back from commercial. If you're doing his job and you don't belong to that union, it would make you a scab. I don't think I'd feel comfortable continuing to work with you.
All of us belong to some kind of broadcasters union. It covers voice actors and crew and the announcer. And for all that, they only have to take union dues out of one person's paycheck for this show.
What?
What?
Here we are at the home of Bill Narrator Sr., what I imagine to be his home, because I'm sick of walking. Yes, this is the place. The side of the mailbox says, The Narrators.
Huh, this is really nice. I wouldn't have thought he could afford a place this big on a narrator's salary. It's got columns from the front porch all the way up to the top of the second story. Are those, Doric columns or Corinthian columns? What do you call that?
I call that pretending to know architecture by dropping the two words you've heard to describe columns.
Fine. How would you describe his house?
That's a two-story bungalow.
It's nice, though.
Yeah, it's pretty nice.
I'll just ring the doorbell. Maybe nothing's wrong. Maybe Bill just overslept.
Hi, Mr. Ziljan.
Billy, we're looking for your father. When did you last see him?
Maybe 2 hours ago.
2 hours. How long have we been walking?
There's no way of knowing. The commercial covered up the passage of time.
Blast.
But it was only a mile and a half. Couldn't have been more than a half hour at the most.
Did he say where he was going?
No, but he left with 3 guys in black suits. See? I told you he was unhappy about how little you were paying him. I bet that's why he went with those men. He's probably negotiating to work at a better-paying studio.
Your theory a minute ago was that he killed himself.
What?
It's okay, Billy. Ziljan didn't believe it. He knows your dad wouldn't do that.
Good.
And I only put the odds at 3-1.
Anyway, those 3 guys kidnapped him at gunpoint.
You seem pretty blasé about your dad getting kidnapped.
Sure, but I knew you'd come along and rescue him. Falk Ziljan, indomitable hero by virtue of the fact that he carries a gun.
That kid's gonna be a great announcer someday. Chip off the old block.
Billy, if you'd gotten hold of us 2 hours ago, we could have had a head start. We don't even know where he's been taken.
The kidnappers were from the Mutually Destructive Radio Network.
I know where that is. It's about 17 miles away, the other side of Santopolis. What do we do for transportation?
I don't know. The bus will take too long.
If you're planning to walk, I'm not going. Say, I can get you there quick.
You have keys to your father's car?
No, we don't have a car. My dad's been teaching me how to narrate. I even did the narration once for this gun in my hand, when Dad was arrested, in episode 72, The Undeniable Narrator. The union gave me flack about it, and Dad explained why it's wrong to be a scab. Anyhow, I can cue up some music so you can just show up where you want to go. We won't even have to discuss how you got there.
That'd be great. Then you can narrate a description of the office, what time it is, the weather, whatever's pertinent.
Sure, I can do that. Are you ready?
Yes, please. The sooner the better.
Okay, let's try this one.
Whoa, whoa, what's this stuff?
Sorry, I forgot you use the same old musical stings every time.
Right, try middle theme with zingy start.
Intractable hero, by virtue of the fact that he carries a gun, Falk Ziljan arrives at the Mutually Destructive Radio Network building, accompanied by the wordsmith and special guest star, Zazu Pitts. It's 14 minutes past 11 p.m., with a cool westerly wind lifting dust off the streets. The building has a tasteful modern style, not too severe. It lacks full-bodied gargoyles, but a few stern-faced visages adorn the—
Thanks, Billy. Your dad would be proud. I mean, he will be proud when he listens to this episode later.
You don't think it was too much? Dad says a little bit goes a long way when it comes to description.
Pardon me for interrupting, but do you think it's wise that we've brought a little boy on a rescue mission? Against armed kidnappers?
Ah, gee, Miss Pitts.
How did you know my name?
Narrator's gotta know all this stuff. I even know how it's gonna turn out.
Don't tell me. I want my reactions to be genuine and off the cuff.
Oh, I gotcha. Method acting. Anyway, don't worry on my account. Mr. Ziljan will keep me safe. Plus, there's a lot of kids that do dangerous radio adventures. Jack Armstrong, the All-American Boy. The Air Adventures of Jimmy Allen. Little Orphan Ein.
All right, here's the plan. Wordsmith, you pick the lock on the door of the loading dock, on the east side of the building. Take Miss Pitts with you. I'll climb the fire escape on the west-northwest wall of the building.
How many wall angles does this polygon have?
The main office of the Mutually Destructive Radio Network is on the 12th floor. You and Miss Pitts get their attention in the office. At that same instant, I'll burst in the back window and we'll have them flanked. That gives us advantage on all melee attack rolls, depending on what edition we're playing.
What?
What?
Great plan, except what makes you think I know how to pick locks?
You're so streetwise, I figured it was something you picked up on the street.
Afraid not.
Boys, I have the door open.
Was it unlocked?
No, I picked the lock with my hairpin.
I'm sorry I underestimated you, Miss Pitts. Thank you very much.
My pleasure, I'm sure. What about me?
Oh, I forgot you were still with us. Boy, you're really good at this narrator stuff, kind of blending into the background until we need you. Why don't you climb up with me? You can wait outside on the fire escape.
Ah, gee, can't I get in the fight?
I'm giving you an important job, Billy. You can stand guard on the fire escape and make sure no one comes up behind me. Then they'd have me flanked.
Everybody ready? Here we go. Middle theme minus the zingy start. Falk and everyone, they execute the plan as described. We rejoin Zazu Pitts and, what's the guy's name, Wordsmith, on the 12th floor as they knock on the glass door of the Mutually Destructive Radio Network main office. Excuse me, sirs. We're looking for a gentleman named William Narrator Sr.?
That's right. We got him. What are the two of you going to do about it?
I'll tell you what we're going to do. We're going to... any minute now. Oh, they got guns.
Oh, dear.
Step inside the office. We'll all sit back cozy until that goofball shows up.
You won't be getting cozy if I have anything to say about it.
Falk Zildjian!
I can't believe it hurts this much to have a Mauser shot out of your hand.
What happened to you busting in the window at the same time we knocked on the door?
I tried. How did you climb 12 flights of stairs that fast?
We took the elevator.
Well, I had to run up the fire escape. Now where's my narrator?
Here I am.
Hi, Dad. I told you Mr. Zildjian would come for you.
Zildjian, why in God's name are you putting my son in danger to confront these kidnappers? They're not just everyday thugs. They're executives.
I don't know. The kid made it sound like it was no big deal.
Oh, you do everything a child says?
Things turned out all right. We only fumbled a little at the start of the episode because we had no opening narration to set the stage.
Why would that be a problem? This isn't the first episode that lacked opening narration. How about episode 100? Episode 97? 86? 82?
All right, I get the picture. You're right. We don't need you.
That's not what I'm saying. You think everything turned out well? How about the Red Sorghum ad scheduled to play in the middle of this episode? Did you remember to read that? Did Billy?
No, he played the Astro Police spot.
See, now the schedule is all loused up. Those Red Sorghum people are going to be breathing down our necks.
Say, Bill, there's one thing that confused me. That goodbye note that got stuck in Falk's pocket as a clue. It was in your handwriting.
That pun was my master stroke. I'm the executive, by the way, in case there are too many characters and their voices sound too similar.
What pun?
The cliche is, goodbye, cruel world. But that note said, goodbye, gruel world, with a G instead of a C. I wanted you to think your narrator was so sick of reading ad copy for Red Sorghum more or less instant breakfast paste, he'd take the easy way out and top himself.
That still sounds difficult.
No, I mean...
We already did the red herring joke.
So how are we going to end the episode with everyone laughing awkwardly in unison?
We'll have to wait for somebody to say something funny.
What do you guys got against my narrator anyway?
Nothing, Zildjian. He was bait to lure you here, so he could kill you.
What did I ever do to you?
This gun in my hand is outperforming the top shows on the Mutually Destructive Radio Network. Little Orphan Ein, Father Cloggin, and up until last week we were the home of Infomars with Alex Joe Hansen. The less said about that, the better. We had to do something to keep our sponsor happy. They're getting outsold by your breakfast gruel.
What could be worse than Red Sorghum more or less instant breakfast paste?
Bob's Red Dawn Barley, the far from instant, in fact let's make a virtue of how gradual it is, breakfast grain.
This gun in my hand is getting better ratings than those ones?
Yeah, I know. It's hard to believe.
It's not funny. No Large Bills, episode 107 of This Gun in My Hand, was created from dues paid by one person, Rob Northrup. This episode and all others are available on YouTube with automatically generated closed captions of dialogue. Visit thisgunninmyhand.blogspot.com for credits, show notes, archives, and to buy my books, such as Little Heist in the Big Woods and Other Revisionist Atrocities. What keeps me from paying ransom with large bills? Being broke. And also, this gun in my hand!